Welcome to Eriksholm Research Centre. My name is James Hart and I'm the Senior Director here. We actually have around 35 to 40 people working here in Eriksholm. They're all typically based in the buildings just over to my right here. Of those, we have about 20, which are, you know, full-time academic staff. We have maybe 10 to 15 PhD students or postdocs working at any given time. And we also have a small team of dedicated clinicians, as well as administrative staff here in Eriksholm, which allows us or the rest of the scientific team to focus on the actual scientific work here. Within our scientific staff, we have psychologists, we have neuroscientists, we have engineers, we have mathematicians, all of which contribute to the quite diverse range of science that we actually do. In addition to the scientific diversity, we actually have a broad team culturally. We actually have about 14 different nationalities working here in Eriksholm. And as you could imagine, that adds a great deal in terms of sort of the social fabric of the organization, as well as, you know, the very diverse professional background that we have. We're actually physically located in Eriksholm, about an hour's drive away from headquarters. The decision to keep us separated was actually made right at the beginning of Eriksholm's life back in 1977. The reason for this is we wanted to keep the core research activities that go on here very much separated from the developmental work that goes on in headquarters. Now, why this is a good thing? It means that Eriksholm scientists can actually focus on the next generation of hearing devices, next generation of technology, next generation of features that can go into our devices, completely independently of the development organization. And that's a really good thing, because the reality is, in an R&D department, there's a lot of, you know, brush fires that need to be put out every day, and there's a lot of immediate concerns. Here we can focus on the important, not on the urgent, and I think that is one of the essence of what Eriksholm is all about. For Oticon, this is also an advantage, because it allows, you know, after an immediate product launch, there's already good ideas waiting in the wings to be able to be included in the next generation devices. So here in Eriksholm, we actually work on three main focus areas. Number one is around personalized audiology, where we try and understand better an individual's hearing loss and then try and find the best possible solution for them with their hearing device. In addition to that, we also look at personalized audiology and trying to understand what their individual needs are in their daily living. And we try and see how we can incorporate that again into the next generation hearing devices. Our second area of research here in Eriksholm is around intent-controlled hearing devices. Put simply, what we're trying to understand is when you're talking to somebody else in a restaurant or in another place, where you're directing your attention at any given time. Because we think if we can decode that using different types of physiological sensors and things that we can put on a hearing aid, we think we're going to be able to tailor that in that hearing aid in the moment to what your needs are in that communication situation. Our third area of research here in Eriksholm is looking at auditory fatigue. Now, listening is effortful. If you have a hearing impairment, it becomes more effortful. It becomes harder and harder for you to communicate in challenging auditory environments, when there's noise, when there's reverberation. What we're trying to do in this sort of pillar of research is actually better understand the cognitive processes that lead to those, to that auditory fatigue. Because if we can understand those basic processes better, it actually means we can build the next generation of devices in a way which best supports your listening in these kinds of difficult environments. Thank you very much for visiting us here at the Eriksholm Research Centre. I would actually like to invite you to join some of my colleagues who will show you some of our research facilities and explain a little bit more about the types of things that we're doing here.
Welcome to the Soundwave Laboratory. My name is Martha, and I'm a scientist. Come on in. So in this room, we like to test how people listen in more natural situations. Typically, when people are getting hearing aids fitted, they might do tests where they have to repeat back single words or sentences that don't really translate to how they listen in real life. You can imagine in real life, you're, you know, there's all these different sounds going on around you. there's multiple people talking, you're looking back and forth between them, you're processing what they're saying, and you're trying to anticipate what they're going to say next. And all of these processes influence how well you hear. Sometimes they can help you, but sometimes they can also make it a bit harder for you. So in this laboratory, we do the experiments that help us understand those processes. We do this by presenting video recordings on this large TV screen here. And the reason it's so big is so that we can present people close to life size. So the participant who is listening to the experiment can see, can experience a more natural situation. We have an array of loudspeakers hidden behind this black screen so that we can present sounds in real spatial dimensions. And we have special eye tracking technology here so that we can actually watch where the participant is looking on the screen. The participant would be wearing glasses like this. And these glasses, as you can see, have these little markers on them. And the position of these markers is tracked by the cameras that are set up near the ceiling in this room. And you can actually see what we see when we look at the data if you look over at the computer monitor here. So the participant is normally wearing these glasses, and we can track their position of their head in the room. You can imagine if someone's listening to something challenging, they might lean forward a little bit in their chair. If there's something going on interesting on the right-hand side of the screen, they might turn their head to look over there. And likewise, if something's going on the left. So I have here an example of some stimuli that we used in a recent experiment. You can see that there's two actors on the screen, and they are holding these white pieces of paper. And each of those pieces of paper actually has a drawing on it. And the actors are comparing their two drawings to see if they can find the differences between them. Next, I'm going to show you a video clip of the conversation that they have while they're trying to do this. And you need to listen to see if you can hear the difference. It's very challenging. It's in Danish. The video always starts with a fixation cross in the middle of the screen, and the participant first has to look at that, so we know where they're looking at the beginning of each trial, and then the conversation comes on. See if you can find out what the difference is that the actors are discussing. Listen carefully.
Og i det andet vindue til venstre, der står tilbud pilleæsker.
Den er helt tom med mig. Og døren er åben ind til apoteket.
The next example I'm going to show is with a little bit of background noise, so it's a little bit more challenging to hear what the actors are saying. For the last example, the noise is going to be quite loud, so prepare yourself. And you're going to see that it starts to be tricky to even pick out the actors' voices from the background. And this is where you start to really pay attention to what their lips are doing. If you want to see how important your lips are, try listening to that with your eyes closed. Now you have an idea of the kind of research we do here. Thank you for visiting the Soundwave Laboratory. Can we do it again?
Welcome to the anechoic room. My name is Lars Bramslev. I'm a senior scientist here at Eriksholm, and I've worked with hearing aids and audiology most of my life. The anechoic room is a room that's meant to keep all sounds from the outside away. And also inside the room, all sounds are absorbed, so it's completely silent. The room is built like a box in a box with this very, very heavy construction. It has double doors, everything meant to isolate the sounds that are coming from the outside. Inside the room, you will see these wedges that are meant to absorb the sound. For some reason, everyone who comes here once has an urge to touch these wedges, and you shouldn't do that because that will destroy them. So if you were here, you could actually try this one right now. So let's go inside. Now we're inside the room, and you probably have the feeling there's absolutely no sound being reflected from the walls. So being in an anechoic room is a bit like if you were standing on a pole in open air and there were absolutely no airplanes making noise or anything. So what I usually do is you can hear the lack of reverb here. I do a clap and there's absolutely nothing coming back from the room. So what is the purpose of this kind of surroundings? Well, that's in order for us to be able to control the acoustics of the room carefully. We can actually define the acoustic conditions very well here, because we can add reverberation on top of what's going on here, and we can test the sensitivity of our human hearing, how sound comes from both sides, and how that creates our sense of the spatial, this acoustic space around us. I actually can play this demo for you. Just a moment. Nu min mus gået. So in this demo, you can actually hear how we can add reverberation to the room and make it appear as if we were in a other room. So you will hear a sentence in some voices that are disturbing.
Father paid at the gate.
So that's a Danish sentence being said from the front here. Now we can simulate as if we were in a very reverberant room, so almost like a church room or another hard room. So listen to this.
Father paid at the gate.
And this happens actually here in the middle of the circle. That's where we can actually create the acoustic scene just as if you were in the church. That's called virtual acoustics, and we can create any scene that we would like to in that manner. The last experiment we ran in here was actually with hearing impaired listeners using hearing aids, and they were listening to speech and noise, and they were expressing how difficult it was depending on the amount of reverberation that we add through this simulation. We also had electrodes attached to the head of the person and used that to measure how much they would have to strain themselves in order to attend to the sounds that were coming from the speaker. So this is just one example of what we can do in the anechoic room, where we'd have people listening to simulated spaces, virtual acoustic spaces. So this is a control room where we actually run the experiment from. You have to imagine the listener is inside the room, and out here we are running the experiment and starting the test and controlling that everything is going as it has to. As I always say, feel free to take a picture before you leave, and thank you for visiting the anechoic room.
Hi, welcome to Pitch Lab. My name is Dorothea Wendt and I'm a senior researcher at Eriksholm. Let me show you what we do in Pitch.
What we typically do here is that we measure our patients' eye movements and pupil size, because the pupil size actually tells us a lot about how people spend their cognitive resources when communicating. So what we do is we seat people in front of the eye tracker, and the eye tracker is simply recording the pupil size of our test subjects, which we call pupillometry. The typical task our test subjects have to perform inside here is to listen to speech and noise and repeat back what they've heard. While they do that, we measure their pupil size as an indicator of the listening effort they have spent. And this is because the pupil starts to dilate as soon as they listen to speech, and we measure this dilation of the pupil. The advantage of pupillometry is that it provides an objective way of assessing our test subject's listening effort, and we are able to run it with our traditional speech and noise test at the same time. In our typical test scenarios, the test subject is sitting inside the booth while we are presenting speech and noise through the loudspeakers like this.
Flowers grow in the garden.
From here, we control the actual experiment. We can track the test subject's eyes, as you can see here, and we can present the sound to our test subjects. Typically, a higher pupil dilation would indicate higher listening effort. And you may wonder how that is possible. Well, this is due to our autonomic nervous system that acts as a stress regulator of our body. In a situation that we perceive as stressful, for example, communication in a noisy environment,
the autonomic nervous system's activity would increase, which has, as a consequence, the dilation, a higher dilation of the pupil. So in this video, you can see a pupil dilation that was recorded of one of our test subjects. And what you can see here is that the pupil dilates as soon as person listening to speech and noise. And the higher the pupil dilation, the more listening effort. What we have learned here is that the more acoustic challenging the listening situation is, the more listening effort people have to spend. And that is reflected in a dilated pupil size. We've also learned that people with hearing loss would typically have to spend more effort in order to reach similar performance or speech intelligibility levels compared to their normal hearing peers. We have also learned that hearing devices and their signal processing can help to reduce the listening effort even in situations where speech intelligibility is high, reflecting everyday communication scenarios. Thank you for visiting Pitch.
Hi, I'm Lawrence, and I would like to show you what kind of experiments we are doing here in our lab called Loudness. In this lab, our participants perform listening tasks while we measure their electroencephalogram, or in short, their EEG. To record EEG signals, we put such a cap on the head of our participants. To this cap, we attach little electrodes that are connected to the scalp of the participants via some conductive gel. Now, what we measure is small changes in electrical potentials that are emitted by the brain. If these changes are very regular, we can see waves of certain frequencies, so-called brain waves. One example is alpha waves. Alpha waves have approximately 10 ups and downs per second, which is their typical frequency. Now, alpha waves are stronger at rest compared to when a participant is involved into a complicated task. This and many other phenomena shows that alpha power is related to the working load the brain has to deal with. Listening in noisy environments is a situation of high working load for the brain. We would like to understand better how the brain is solving that situation and how hearing aids can help the brain to do so. This is one reason why we measure EEG. There's other brain waves that are more closely related to what the participant is actually listening to. Listen to my voice. You may hear that speech follows a certain rhythm. This rhythm is created by the way the words are expressed in a certain speed, how their syllables are connected, and how they are interrupted by short moments of silence. Now, if we ask participants to listen to a voice, we can see in the EEG that their brain is following that rhythm. Now imagine that we present two talkers at the same time, and we ask participants to attend one of them and to ignore the other. Since each of those talkers has their own rhythm, we can see in the EEG which of the two the brain of the listeners is following. And this is very valuable information when it comes to developing hearing aids that should support selective attention. And this is another reason why we measure EEG. Besides measuring EEG in the lab, we also would like to let hearing aid users benefit from EEG more directly. This is why we developed these earpieces, which have little EEG electrodes attached, such that a hearing aid may be able to measure EEG and adapt to the current listening situation. For example, based on the alpha waves, a hearing aid could estimate how difficult a listening situation is, or based on the rhythm of the talkers, a hearing aid could estimate which of the two talkers is currently attended. And this is why we measure ear EEG. If you look up here, you can see what a real experiment looks like. I hope I could shed some light on what we are doing here in our Loudness lab. Thank you for visiting.
Ah, and this and that.
Welcome to the Eriksholm Clinic. My name is Louise Lystrup and I work as a research clinician here at Eriksholm. So come on in. At Eriksholm we have around 300 people with hearing impairment working as test subjects. And our test subjects are very valuable for us because they provide a lot of insights into what it is being a person with a hearing impairment and living the daily life with hearing loss and hearing aids. Every year we get a lot of applications from hearing impaired persons who would like to be a test subject at the Eriksholm. And we invite them for a screening visit here in the clinic and to be sure to find out if they fit the criteria that we have for being a test subject here. When we recruit new test subjects for our test subject panel, we do always start out with a recruitment period where we focus on fitting and fitting the hearing aids and make sure that everything is working the best way before the test subjects will be released for participation in the research projects. The research that they will be invited for can be very different kind of projects. So they could, for instance, be invited for a field test where they should try a setting in a hearing aid or try out a new feature in an app. They could also be invited for focus groups where they should talk about a certain topic related to hearing and hearing loss. They could also be invited for a test in one of our laboratories, and that could be, for instance, an EEG test or a pupillometry. They could also help us in developing questionnaires where we need some feedback on how the questionnaires are working. If we can use a person here in our test subject panel, then they will be fitted with Oticon hearing aids. We do always do that, fit them with the newest hearing aids, and they are not released for participation in the research studies before we are sure that everything is working fine and that they are well functioning with the hearing aids and that they are actually happy hearing aid users. We serve as the test subjects clinic, so we take care of all the rehabilitation, and the rehabilitation includes audiometric measures that we conduct here. And it also includes fitting and fine-tuning of hearing aids. It includes counseling whenever a person needs some advice about their hearing or living with hearing loss. And it also includes impressions, taking impressions of the ears if that is needed. We do also have the possibility of using the remote care fittings, and that is very great opportunity, so we can fit the hearing aids without people being present here at Eriksholm. Remote care is a very useful tool for us in the fitting process, and it gives the test subject the opportunity of being in his or her own environment when we're doing the fittings, and that way they can try the new fittings right away and give us feedback on how it's working. Thank you for visiting the Eriksholm Clinic.
Hello and welcome to the Eriksholm Collection. My name is Claus Nielsen, and I would like to show you some of the things that we have in the collection. The collection is one of Europe's biggest collections. It contains hearing aids and hearing trumpets. Let me show you something. I have something over here. So, this is the oldest Danish hearing aid. It was manufactured by Oticon, and if you look carefully at the black microphone here, you can actually see that it says Oticon on the grill. It was a vacuum tube hearing aid with two batteries. These are one of the old Danish brands. And then we also have the small ear mold here. This is actually a microphone in a hearing aid, and it's pretty big. It's a double microphone. This was how a microphone looked like around about 1910. In order to understand what has really happened during those many years, we now make a fast forward up to 2010. What you see here is a sliced behind the ear hearing aid has been cut in the middle. And up in the top here, you can actually see the small microphone. So it's like several hundred times smaller than it used to be. We have something like 800 to 1,000 items on display, hearing aids, and we cover the period from 1850 up till today, long before the electrical hearing aids. In this drawer here, down here, we have hearing aids that all belonged to the same lady, starting from 1924 when she got the first hearing aid until 1971 when she died. And I want to share something with you that I have not shown before, which is a hearing aid that got donated from one of our hearing aid dispensing chains in France. What you see here is a real Cartier earring with a built-in hearing aid. So the idea was to clip the earring on the ear and then attach the ear mold into the ear canal. And then you had an inconspicuous hearing aid. By the way, there's one more thing I want to show you. Follow me. As you know, Hans Demand, he founded Oticon, and the first product he sold was an electrical ear massager that you see here. And the customer was actually a doctor, and you see him here in the original ledger. If you want to know more about the Eriksholm collection, please visit our website. And I would now like to thank you for visiting the Eriksholm collection. Thank you.